Hi guys, this is Vaish from Vaisha Yes, and we are going to continue the R.S. Sharma. Chapter 12 we are going to do, and this is actually again about the Buddha age. Nothing about the Buddha or Siddhartha. It is about the society and the Varna system and what all things flourished, what are the material life, what are the occupations, all those things during the Buddha age. Okay, that 6th century, 3rd century, that BC, that time what was happening, the society things are there in this chapter. Lot of actual things will be there, so try to make notes of whatever I tell you. And if you have to practice, try to get the test series. It's already launched. The link will be given in the description box to explain to you what all things are there in my test series. 36 sets are there. That's the gist of it. 36 sets in covering all the topics, and most number of PDF is for polity. Okay, 8 sets is for polity, covering the entire Lakshmikant, 100% coverage of Lakshmikant. And then 6 sets of current affairs are there, and then 3 or 4 sets for all the history, like modern history 3 sets are there, 4 sets are there, medieval and ancient 3 sets are there, art and culture 2 sets are there, then I think science and tech schemes, current affairs, art, what else is there, government schemes, science and tech, whatever, economy, whatever topics are there for UPSC, everything, at least 2 sets are there, 200 to 250 questions is the minimum count for everything. Okay, so try to get that. Totally you will get 36 set. Okay, and that is around 3600 MCQs, which is of all high quality. We don't ask any junk questions like in most of the test series. Everything will be taken from standard textbooks only. Even the ancient history textbook sample questions you will see, and at the end of this video, it is all taken directly from R.S. Sharma statements only. So that is the best which any channel can offer you. So try to get that test series. Now we'll begin chapter 12, that is the Buddha age. This is the PDF, chapter 12, state and Varna society in the age of the Buddha. So as I told, material life is what they're dealing with. The picture of material life in North India, especially in eastern Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, can be drawn on the basis of the Pali text and the Sanskrit Sutra literature in combination with the archaeological evidence. So there is literature and also archaeological evidence which will tell you about the material life of those people. Archaeologically, the 6th century BC marks the beginning of NBP phase. What is NBP? Northern Black Polished Ware. Okay, we have seen painted grey ware, we have seen red and black pottery, and now this is something new, Northern Black Polished Ware. Okay, this is the pottery or the utensil used at that time, the Buddha age, 6th century BC, which has a very glossy, shining type of pottery. The pottery was made up of very fine fabric and apparently served as the tableware of richer people. In association with this pottery are found iron implements, especially those meant for crafts and agriculture. This phase also saw the beginning of metallic money. Okay, such facts UPSC will pick up. Metallic money for the first time used in the Buddha age. The use of burnt bricks and ring wells appeared in the middle of the NBP phase. So the burnt bricks which Harappans had used, and then in the Vedic period nobody used it, now it has come back, okay, during the Buddha age. So ring wells were also there, and this is around the 3rd century BC. The NBP phase marked the beginning of the second urbanization in India. So this is the second urbanization. UPSC have already asked this question. So the first urbanization was in the time of Harappan. After that, you saw Vedic age, it was more of mud settlements and fortified buildings. But the urban life is coming back in the Buddha age. That is the time of this Mahajanapadas. After that, for about 1000 years, we do not find any towns in India. With the appearance of towns in the middle Gangetic basin in the 6th century BC, a second urbanization began in India. Many towns mentioned in the Pali and Sanskrit texts, such as Kausambi, Sravasti, Ayodhya, Kapilavastu, Varanasi, Vaisali, Rajgir, Pataliputra, Champa, these are all places you should be familiar by now. Okay, we have done in 2-3 chapters already, and they have been excavated, and in each case signs of habitation and mud structures belonging to the advent of the NBP phase or its middle have been found. So these cities, you know, it will be like having traces of all the timeline, right? But it is selling even NBP phase were found. Many things, artifacts were found from these places based on this timeline. And again, Patna, these places again they're telling. And all those 7-storied palaces are all mentioned in Pali text. Such things are not discovered. Okay, so in textbooks always it's like exaggerated. Too much exaggeration will be there. So 7-storied buildings or palaces are mentioned, but nothing has been discovered till now. Okay, many towns were seats of government, but whatever be the causes of their origin, they eventually turned out to be markets and came to be inhabited by artisans and merchants. So the cities and all, they flourished only when trade happened. Okay, whatever reason the towns originated, later everything became a market town, you can tell. That is what trade was flourishing. At some places there were concentration of artisans. Sadalaputta at Vaishali had 500 potters. Okay, shops were there. 500 potter shops were there at this place at Vaisali. Both artisans and merchants were organized into guilds under the respective headmen. We hear of 18 guilds of artisans, but only the guilds of smith, carpenters, leather workers, and painters are specified. Both artisans and merchants lived in fixed localities in towns. We hear of Vesas or merchants streets in Varanasi. Okay, so these are merchant streets. Okay, Vesas, merchants. Similarly, we hear of the street of ivory workers. The specialization in crafts developed on account of the guild system as well as localization. Generally, crafts were hereditary and the son learned his family trade from his father. So, the occupation was passed on from generation to generation. These are again regions. If you want, you can pause and see the distribution of the pottery. It's all near the Ganga belt and all those places, the Mahajanapadas, which I already told you. The products of crafts were carried over long distance by merchants. We repeatedly hear of 500 cartloads of goods. These contained fine textile goods, ivory objects, pots, etc. All the important cities of the period were situated on river banks and trade routes and connected with one another. Shravasti was linked with the both the cities, okay, Kausambi and Varanasi. The latter was considered to be great center of trade. That is, Varanasi was considered as great center of trade in the age of Buddha. The route from Shravasti passed eastward and southward towards Kapilavastu and Kushinara and came to Vaisali. So they are just linking, interconnecting all those cities and telling they had all internal trade within themselves. Traders crossed the Ganga near Patna and went to Rajgir. They also went to the Ganga River to Champa near modern Bhagalpur. If we believe the Jataka stories, in the traders of Kosala and Magadha went via Mathura as far northward as Taxila. So Taxila, you know, it is in present day Pakistan, Afghanistan region. So that much far they used to go for trading. Similarly, from Mathura, they went to Ujjain and the Gujarat coast. So westwards also and northwards also, it was too much territorial region was covered under their trade. Now two terms, the term Nishka and Satamana in the Vedic text are taken to be names of coins, but coins actually found are not earlier than the 6th century BC. It seems that the Vedic text exchange was carried on through means of barter. So in the Vedic times it was mostly barter system, but in the time of this Buddha age, Nishka and Satamana is mentioned, which are coins. Okay, so coin system, metallic money, everything started in the time of Buddha age. And again, coins made of metal appear first in the age of Gautama Buddha. The earlier era made largely of silver, though a few copper. So silver coins were there, copper coins were there. Okay, and it was punchmarked. Punchmark means a punch. It was like punched with certain marks. That is hills, trees, fish, bull, elephant, crescent. All these symbols were there. So punchmarked coins. The earliest hoards of the coins have been found in eastern Uttar Pradesh and Magadha. Although some early coins are also found in Taxila. So in eastern UP you can tell, and also in the Taxila regions coins were found. And the Pali text also mentions about it. And it's all universal coins, like even the price of a dead mouse, they are telling that is for each and everything. Now money is being used. It is likely that writing started a couple of centuries before Ashoka had contributed to trade. So they are telling about the early writings now. Okay, writings and all, they told first they are written in perishable things like wood and all. That is why it is not retained. And they were used not only for this official thing, I mean the kingdom thing, but also for the record keeping, trading and all these things also. The writing practice was used. That is what they are telling about the writing session. So pottery we saw, coins we saw, trade and craft we saw, and writing also we saw. Okay, now although rural settlements belonging to the NPP phase have not been excavated, we cannot think of the beginning of craft, commerce and urbanization in the middle Gangetic basin without a strong rural base. Okay, princes, priests, artisans, traders, administrators, military personnel, numerous other functionaries could not live in the towns unless taxes, tributes and thithis. Taxes were available in sufficient measures to support them. So they are telling if they had to flourish, this trade alone is not sufficient. The prince, everyone should also collect taxes also. So taxation system was there. Then non-agriculturists living in towns has to be fed by agriculturists living in villages. Again, same thing like in present day, without villages, without the rural farmers, the urban life cannot be sustained because they need food which will obviously come from the villages. In return, artisans and traders living in towns made tools, cloth, etc. available to the rural folk. So it was like a mutual exchange. They'll get tools from the urban people and they'll get food from the rural people. So we hear of a village trader depositing 500 plots with the town merchant. So there are a lot of cases. There's just writings which is discovered. Okay, not very important. Numerous villages were mentioned in the Pali text, and town seems to have been situated amidst the cluster of villages. It seems that the nucleated rural settlement in which all people settled at one place and their agricultural lands. It's not important. I'm just keeping it. Okay, leave it. Here, village headman. Village headman is called Bojaka. So these kind of terms are very important for us in prelims perspective. The second included suburban villages, which were in the nature of craft villages. For instance, a carpenter's village lay in the vicinity of Varanasi. So there were suburban villages. That is, in each occupation, they will have their own craft villages. Okay. Obviously, these villages served as markets for other villages and linked the towns with the countryside. So they had this interconnection because of that only. Because to purchase one thing, you have to go to that particular village and purchase it. The third category consists of border villages situated on the limit of the countryside, which merged into forest. Okay. So border villages were there, which like it had merged partially. It is like in the forest. People living in these villages were mainly fowlers and hunters and led a backward life. So these border villages people were backward. The village lands were divided into cultivable plot and allotted family wise. Every family cultivated its plots with the help of its members, supplemented by that of agricultural labor. So even the family workers and also hired workers participated in the agriculture of a particular plot. Fields were fenced and irrigation channels dug collectively by the peasant families under the supervision of the village headman. Village headman is Bojaka. Okay. The peasants had to pay 1/6 of their produce as tax. Try to remember all these things, because in later medieval time we will be learning lot of taxes. Okay. So 1/6 of the taxes what they had to give in the Buddha age. The taxes were collected directly by the royal agents, and generally there were no intermediate landlords between the peasants on the one hand and the state on the other. But some villages were granted to Brahmanas and big merchants for their enjoyment. Okay, so that kind of things were also happening. We also hear of large plots of land worked with the help of slaves and agriculture laborers. Rich peasants were called Grihapatis. So Bojaka was village headman, Grihapati is rich peasants. Okay, and they were mostly the Vaishyas. So rice was the staple cereal produced in eastern Uttar Pradesh and Bihar in this period. Various types of paddy and paddy fields were described in the Pali text. The use of the terms of transplantation is found in the Pali and Sanskrit text of this period, and it seems that large scale paddy transplantation began in the age of Buddha. Paddy transplantation or wet paddy production enormously added to the yield. In addition, the peasants also produced barley, pulses, millets, cottons and sugarcane. Okay, so it was a production oriented society, you can tell. They were producing almost everything, and that too in huge numbers, because they had to pay 1/6 as tax. Okay, Grihapatis is the rich peasants who used to maintain lot of land under them. Agriculture made great advance because of the use of the iron plowshare and immense fertility of the alluvium soil in the area between Allahabad and Rajmahal. You know the Ganga basin, it's full of alluvium soil, and that is why agriculture flourished. Again, they are telling that crucial role of iron, soil and all those things, Rajgarh, Varanasi. There's nothing new here. Then iron mines are there, so iron tools could be easily made. Pali text, Sanskrit textbook, all these mentioned the same thing. So advanced food producing economy it is. Then made collection of taxes easier. So such things, it's all same thing they're repeating. Okay, administrative system. Although we hear the many states in the period, only Kosala and Magadha emerged as powerful. Okay, both of them were ruled by the hereditary monarch belonging to the Kshatriya Varna. The Jatakas, or the stories relating to the previous birth of the Buddha, tell us that oppressive kings and their chief priest were expelled by the people and new kings were installed. So it is like kind of direct democracy. Okay, people were overthrowing the oppressive kings and then new king was installed. Such things are happening as per Jataka tales. Okay, Jataka stories. But occasions of expulsions were as rare as those of election. So election also rarely happened, and this expulsion also rarely happened. That is the actual thing. Even though textbook tells many things, this is the actual thing. So the king enjoyed the highest official status and special protection for his person and property. He yielded ground only to great religious leaders of the stature of the Buddha. The king was primarily a warlord who led his kingdom from victory to victory. This is well illustrated by the careers of Bimbisara and Ajatashatru. We have seen all these Magadha rulers already in the previous chapter. So he was the one who was like a warlord. The king ruled with the help of officials, both high and low. So the higher officials is called Mahamatras. So Bojaka, Grihapatis, Mahamatras, every term as the following, it will come. Okay, UPSC will directly pick it from here. And so individual ministers like that's Mantrin, and the commander Sena Nayaka, judge was there, chief accountant was there, head of the royal harem is there, everything is there. Okay, and also officers called Ayuktas is there, who performed a similar function in some of the state. Okay, so under the state provinces and all, there were officers like this, Ayuktas. Then the king carried on administration with the help of officers. Varsakara of Magadha and Dirka Charayana of Kosala. So because Magadha and Kosala are two important kingdoms, they are just mentioning two officer names also, Varsakara and Dirka Charayana. It's not very important, but you should know they were influential ministers in those huge kingdoms. The first succeeded in sowing seeds of dissension in the rank of the Lichavis of Vaisali and enabled others through to conquer the republic. Not important. The second rendered help to the king of Kosala. They're telling what these people did, okay, these influential ministers. It seems that high officers and ministers were largely recruited from the priestly class of the Brahmanas. Okay, so these high officials and ministers were from the priestly class of the Brahmanas. So these Brahmanas are getting land, getting donation, getting gift, and now getting jobs also. Okay, so they flourished, or they were very much happy under these kingdoms. Generally, they do not seem to have belonged to the clan of the king. These ministers were not from the clan of the king, it was from Brahmanas. In both Kosala and Magadha, despite the use of panchmark coins made of silver, influential Brahmanas and Sethis were paid by the grant of the revenue of the village. Okay, so panchmark coins were there in silver and all, but these people were even given land grants, okay, from the villages. It's not like only money, they were given land grants also. In doing so, the king did not have to obtain the consent of the clan, so was the case in later Vedic times, but the beneficiaries were granted only revenue. They were not given any administrative authority. So there is no powers given to them, they were given land and money and all those gifts and all. The rural administration was in the hands of the village headman. In the beginning, the headman functioned as a leader of the tribal regiments, and so they were called Gramini, which means the leader of the Grama or a tribal military unit. Okay. So the leader was initially called Gramini. As life became sedentary and flock cultivation well established, tribal contingents settled down to agriculture. The Gramini therefore was transformed into a village headman in pre-Mauryan times. The village headmen were known by different titles. Okay, Grama Bojaka, we have already seen that Bojaka. So Gram Bojana, Gramini, Gramika, everything is a title for village headman. 86,000 Gramikas were said to have been summoned by Bimbisara. At the time of Bimbisara, that many people were there as Gram Bojakas. So that many villages were there. The number may be conventional, but it shows that the village headman enjoyed considerable importance and had direct link with the king. The village headman assessed and collected the taxes from the villages, and they maintained law and order in the locality. So they were in charge of everything, even tax collection and maintaining law and order in the villages. They were in direct contact with the kings. Army and taxation. The real increase in the state power is indicated by the formation of a large professional army. So, okay, the better the army, the better will be the kingdom. So at the time of Alexander's invasion, the Nanda ruler, I already told you, 20,000 cavalry, 2 lakh infantry, 2,000 horse chariots, 4,000 elephants. In the last chapter, it was mentioned 6,000 elephants. Okay, so we don't know what is right, but around these many cavalry they had. The chariots were losing their importance not only in the northeast, but also in the northwest India, where they had been introduced by the Aryans. Very few elephants were maintained by the rulers of the states in northwest India. Though some of them maintained as many horses as the Magadhan king did, the possession of numerous elephants gave an edge to the Magadhan princes. So because of this huge number of elephants, this was Magadhan kings were considered more powerful. The large long service army had to be fed by the state exchequer. Okay, because if you have a huge army, you have to feed them also, right? So we are told that the Nandas possessed enormous wealth, which must have enabled them to support the army. But we have no clear idea of the measures by which they raise taxes from the people. So the taxation system is not clear under the Nanda dynasty. But they obviously should have some taxation system so that they could maintain the army. That is what they are telling. The fiscal system was established on a firm basis. Warriors and priests, that is the Kshatriyas and the Brahmanas, were exempted from the payment of taxes. So if you see, Brahmanas and Kshatriyas both did not pay taxes. So obviously, entire pressure will be on the peasants, the Vaisyas, the Grihapatis and all those people, right? And Bali is a voluntary payment made by the tribesmen to their chiefs in Vedic times. So that is about the Vedic time, not the Buddha age. Vedic time, there was something like Bali, which is a voluntary payment, okay? And became a compulsory payment. That time it was voluntary, and now in the Buddha time, it became a compulsory payment to be made by the peasants. And officers called Bali Sadakas were appointed to collect it. It seems that 1/6 of the produce was collected as tax by the king. So 1/6 tax is same, but that voluntary payment, which was the Bali, it became compulsory in the Buddha age. Taxes were assessed and collected by royal agents with the help of village headman. The advent of writings may have helped the assessment and collection of taxes. The discovery of many hordes of panchmark coins suggest that the payment was made in both cash and kind. Okay, UPSC have asked this kind of question already in the past, like taxes were collected only in cash. So you should know, like, it is not only cash, it is cash and kind. Okay, in northeastern India, payment was made in paddy. So even other than money, they used to give paddy or whatever is cultivated, that also can be given as taxes. And peasants were subjected to forced labor. Obviously, when you need a lot of taxes, all the pressure will be on the peasants only. So forced labor was also there. And this is actually one important thing. The tolls were collected by officers known as Saulkika or Sulkadyaksha? Okay, this MCQ I have asked you in my previous video. That time if you could not get the answer, now try to go and see that MCQ one more time and see whether this option was there. Tall collection answer, choice was there in that question. Okay, so Sulkadyaksha is the toll collecting officer under the Buddha age. The age is also important, the post and the timeline. There is no Sabha or Samiti now, because in the Vedic time, you know, early Vedic time there was Sabha where woman entry was there. Then later in the later Vedic period, Sabha was still there but woman could not enter. So such things were there, but by the Buddha age all these things disappeared. Okay, totally disappeared. And place was taken by Varna. So now there is no Sabha, Samiti and all. There is only Varna system and caste system, which we already know, the Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya, Shudra and all. Then here nothing important is there. With the emergence of last state of Kosala and Magadha, it was not possible to hold big assemblies attended by people, because now it's huge kingdom, so it's not possible to have that kind of village gathering. Okay, that is the reason they are telling. Small body called Parishad is there. Okay, consisting exclusively of the Brahmanas. So Parishad is having only Brahmanas. Okay. Republican experiment, because you know monarchy was one thing, and now they are trying the republican thing. Republican means elected head. Okay, so the republican system of government existed either in the Indus basin or in the foothills of the Himalayas in eastern Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. The republics in the Indus basin have been remnants of the Vedic tribes, although some monarchies may have been followed by the republics. In some cases in Uttar Pradesh and Bihar, people were possibly inspired by the old ideals of tribal equality, which did not give much prominence to the Raja. So if you remember, in the early Vedic period, Raja was just a hereditary position and he did not have ultimate power. So people now in Buddha age are getting inspired by that model and they wanted that kind of model to come back. Okay, in the republic, real power laid in the hands of the tribal oligarchies. Okay, so oligarchy is something like too many kings, so get lot of kings ruling together, that is oligarchy. Monarchy is one king and oligarchy is lot of kings. So in the republics of Sakyas and Lichavis, the ruling class belonged to the same clan and the same varna. Although in the case of Lichavis of Vaishali, 7707 Rajas, so they are telling that many, 7000 Rajas sat on the assembly held in the hall. The Brahmanas were not included in this group. Okay, so Brahmanas were not included in this group of oligarchy kings. Okay, and then Malavas and Shudrakas, the Kshatriyas, the Brahmanas were given citizenship, but slaves and hired laborers were excluded from it. So Brahmanas were excluded, hired laborers were excluded, slaves were excluded. In a state, So in a state situated in the Bias River in Punjab, membership are restricted to those who could supply at least one elephant to the state. So membership to the place near Punjab is based on if you can give an elephant to it or not. Okay, so obviously it will be having limited people only. The administrative machinery of the Sakyas and Lichavis was simple. It consisted of a Raja, Uparaja, that is a vice king, Senapati, that is a commander, and Bandagarika, that is the treasurer. We hear of as many as 7 courts for trying the same case one after another in the Lichavi Republic, but this seems to be too good to be true. Okay, so they are telling efficient justice system and all those things they had, but it's all written facts only, so it is like very hard to believe. Okay, such things even happened. In any case, certain states in the age of the Buddha were not ruled by hereditary kings but by person who were responsible to the assemblies. Okay, so there was some sort of accountability and responsibility by the rulers to the people. Thus, although the people living in ancient republics may not have shared political power equally, the republic tradition in the country is as old as the age of the Buddha. The republics differed from the monarchies in several ways. In the monarchies, the king claimed to be the sole recipient of the revenue from the peasants, but in the republics, this claim was advanced by every tribal oligarch who was known as the Raja. So each one of the 7000 Lichavi Rajas maintained his storehouse and apparatus of administration. Okay, so even though everybody ruled together, they all maintained their own storehouse and their own method of administration. Okay, and the revenue collection will be shared equally between everyone. Again, every monarchy maintained its regular standing army and did not permit any group or groups of people to keep arms within its boundaries. But in a tribal oligarchy, each Raja was free to maintain his own little army under his Senapati. So even though these 7000 Rajas were ruling together, everybody had their own kind of administration, their own standing army and their own policies. Okay, and commander will be Senapati, okay, the army commander. Now the Brahmanas exercised great influence in the monarchy, but they had no place in the earlier republic. So that's also one very good thing which happened. Okay, till now Brahmanas were having too much influence over the kingdoms, over that king and all in monarchy, but in oligarchy there is no role for Brahmanas. Then the main difference between the monarchy and the republic lay in the fact that the latter functioned under the leadership of oligarchic assemblies and not of an individual, as with the case of the former. Okay, again the group kings. Now the republican tradition became feeble from the Mauryan period. Even in the pre-Mauryan times, monarchies were far stronger and common. Okay, so by the time of Mauryas, it is declining. Naturally, ancient thinkers looked upon kingship as the common and most important form of government. To them, the state, government and kingship meant the same thing. Okay, so for them, everything is same. The earlier thinkers, state, government, kingship, everything is the same person. Since the state was well established in the age of the Buddha, thinkers began to speculate about its possible origins. Now, this is one important Buddha text, okay, Buddhist text. Dikha Nikaya. Dikha Nikaya, one of the earliest Buddhist Pali text. Okay, you should remember all these things. It's a Buddhist text, it is written in Pali language and it is called Dikha Nikaya. It points out that in the earliest stage, human beings lived happily. Gradually, they came to have private property and set up house with their wives. So, they began to quarrel over property and women. In order to put an end to the quarrel, they elected a chief who would maintain law and order and protect people. In return for protection of the people, the people promised to give to the chief a part of their paddy. Okay, so this is a story kind of thing they are telling, how the system was being managed in Dikha Nikaya, which is a Buddhist Pali textbook. Okay, people were happy initially, then they married, then they had quarrels, and to solve that they had a chief, and for the protection they'll give taxes in the form of paddy. Okay, so that is how the kingship originated. They're telling how a story of king or how a ruler emerged. The story of idea of a ruler emerged is because of that thing, whatever we explained now. Now, social orders and legislation. The Indian legal and judicial system originated in this period. Okay, so the legal judicial system, we already saw something like seven courts where they are trying the same court and all, which was too good to be true. So they are telling all these things emerged at this time. Formerly, people were governed by the tribal law, which did not recognize any class distinction. But by now, the tribal communities had been clearly divided into four classes. Again, that Varna system. Okay. So the Dharma Sutras, that is the Brahminical code of law, laid down the duties of each of the four Varnas, and the civil and criminal law came to be based on the Varna division. So now laws are being divided based on this thing. Okay, so every problem which is there in India now is all beginning here. Now the higher the Varna, purer it is. Okay, and the higher was the order of the moral conduct expected by the civil and criminal law. All kinds of disabilities were imposed on the Sutras. They were deprived of religious and legal rights and relegated to the lowest position in the society. Okay, Shudras were downtrodden and treated very badly. They could not be invested with the Upanayana. Upanayana, I told you that sacred thread ceremony of the Brahmanas. All the other three classes can do, but Shudras cannot participate in Upanayana. Crimes committed by them against the Brahmanas and others were punished severely. On the other hand, the crimes committed against the Shudras were punished lightly. Okay, so there is no rights for Shudras. The lawgivers emphasized the fiction that the Shudras were born from the feet of the Creator. So members of the higher Varna, especially the Brahmanas, shunned the company of the Shudra, avoided the food touched by them, and refused to enter into marriage relations with him. He could not be appointed to high post, and above all, he was specifically asked to serve the twice born as slave. Twice born, Dvija, that term I already explained to you, that all the other classes were considered twice born. Okay, and the Shudras were demarcated from them and was considered slave. In this respect, even Jainism and Buddhism did not make any substantial change in the position of the Shudras. Okay, the Jainism and Buddhism, you know, they did not oppose much to the Varna system. Okay, they just tried to do something different, but they did not oppose it strongly. So that is why later it declined also, the Buddhism declined also. Then Gautam Buddha visited the assembly of the Brahmanas, the Kshatriyas and the Draupadis householders, but the assembly of the Shudras is not mentioned in the connection. So there are mentions about Gautama Buddha going and visiting all these people, the Brahmanas, Kshatriyas and all, but there is no mention about he visiting any gathering of Shudras. Okay. Then civil and criminal law was administered by the royal agents, who incited rough and ready punishment such as the scourging, beheading, tearing out of the tongue. So there were very severe punishment and almost everything was directed towards the Shudras. In many cases, punishments for criminal offenses were governed by the idea of revenge. It means tooth for tooth and eye for eye. So kind of revenge things happened. That is why more and more criminal offenses were happening at that time. Although the Brahminical law book, that is the Dharma Sutras and all, took into account the social status of the different Varnas in framing their laws, they did not ignore the customs of those non-Vedic tribal groups who were gradually absorbed into the Brahminical social order, which went on expanding as a result of conquest. Okay, so this Brahminical group was going on expanding because people were getting absorbed into it, the non-Vedic tribal people, so that was also considered while making the laws. Some of these indigenous tribals were given fictitious social origins, and what is further important, they are allowed to be governed by their own customs. Okay, so now, as I told you, laws are being customized based on different customs. The age of the Buddha is important because ancient Indian polity, economy and society really took shape in this period. agriculture based on the use of iron tools in rural areas gave rise to the advanced food processing economy, particularly in eastern Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. It was possible to collect taxes from the peasants, and on the basis of regular taxes and tributes, large states could be founded. In order to continue the system, the Varna order was devised, okay, and the functions of each Varna were clearly laid down. According to the system, rulers and fighters were all Kshatriyas. Priests and teachers were Brahmanas. Peasants and taxpayers were Vaishyas, and those who served all three classes were the Shudras. So this is the whole story of the society. Lot of information is there. You physically can frame statements in any form. Let's see some model questions, but not based on this chapter. I think I have took questions from here and there from our PDFs. Okay, so the Buddha age. The first question, which of the following elements of Buddhism are not matched correctly? This was actually covered in the previous chapter, I think. So try to recollect Buddham, Dhammam and Sangham. What does it mean? Okay, whether it's matched correctly or if anything is wrong. Pause the slide and try to answer in comment section. So we'll see the next question now. Which of the following pottery were available in the later Vedic phase? We have already covered later Vedic phase. You have to tell me. Painted greyware, red, black slipped, red and black. Actually, more than in this R.S. Sharma, I have covered all these things in the NCRT textbook of class 6. Okay, class 6 NCRT plus R.S. Sharma is the books which you need to do, must do books for ancient history. Okay, so try to answer it. Which all are true regarding the 6th century, often called as the Buddha age? Okay, this is related to this chapter. So, silver coins were first introduced in India in this phase. It is also called the NBP phase, that is the Northern Black Polished Ware. Village headman was called as Grampojaga, Gramika, or Gramini. Peasants paid 50% of produce as tax directly to royal agent and not the landlords. Rich peasants were called Grihapatis. So whether everything is true or if anything is false, try to answer it in comment section. Okay. By the test series, you will get around 300 MCQs of ancient and medieval history. 300 each, okay, 600 MCQs you will get. That is the best collection you will get. Everything is from NCRTs and standard books like R.S. Sharma and Satish Chandra. So try to get it and practice, contact me, see the link in the description below. Okay, so till I come to the next video, thank you and have a nice day.